Hi everyone, welcome to the end of our 8 week of classes this semester. I hope that everybody is okay. So today we'll continue with relational algebra and actually SQL. We'll actually dive more into SQL and you will see the fun parts of SQL this semester. One fun part is what happens with nulls. For instance, if you try to compare a null or you can try to do the summation of a null attribute with another value, you get null. And then if you use it in a comparison with other values, you get a new value called undefined or unknown, which basically it's used in the where clause. And very interestingly, it has different functionalities. For instance, if you count, you would basically get, you can count null objects. Other aggregates do not work on null. So I will basically tell you more about how does a null behave with SQL, which is quite interesting, and how SQL has a three-valued semantics, true, false, and undefined, because the where condition can have these undefined values based on null. Okay, so let's continue with aggregates. So last class, we talked about SQL, and we learned about the where condition, the select condition, which are basically the relational algebra operations. Aggregates are something that are not in relational algebra. Relational algebra had select, project, join. It didn't have aggregates. Aggregates is in SQL, and it's totally normal to have aggregates, like you want to count how many tuples you get from your result, or how many classes does the professor teach, or you want to sum, like for instance, you want to sum the number of credits that a student takes overall, or you want an average, the average grade in the class, or you want a maximum, a minimum grade in a class, and so on. So these are producing numbers, and as I told you last time, you can basically use them. You can use them either over all of the possible tuples that you get back as a result, like count in this example, or you can use them count distinct, how many different distinct values you get for a certain column. You can use max over an attribute, and you basically compute the maximum value for salary from all of the tuples that you are getting from the query below. And here are a few examples. For instance, if I want the number of courses taught in the fall of 2020, I basically do a select count and the course code where from teaching where the semester is 2020. If multiple sections of the same class are taught, then you count distinct values of the course code. So you see that you can use distinct within the aggregate. Then we talked about grouping. So for instance, if you want to find out how many classes every professor teaches or how many classes every student takes, you can basically group by that ID that you are interested in. So for instance, this is an example of for every professor, I want to get how many distinct classes that professor is teaching. And similarly, you can do the same for student. If you modify the professor ID in the strategy too, to student ID, you would get for a specific semester, fall of 2020, how many classes every student is taking. So here you can see two things, that if the group by has an attribute, you can include that attribute in the select part, like the projection on what attributes you will get out. For those attributes that do not appear in the group by condition, you can use aggregates over them, like count, max, mean, sum, and so on. Because basically what it does is for that entire group, it computes a single value for that specific group. And here is an example. Basically the group by a list of attributes will basically separate those attributes. And for those that have the same value, it creates a group of all the tuples for those additional values. Now, for every group, you can take out the sum attributes which are part of the group by list. And then you have aggregates over the rest of the attributes. So you can compute max, mean, and so on. If you don't have any aggregates, you would basically only have the tuples corresponding to the different groups that you got out. Okay. So group by is a way to separate into groups the tuples and then run individual queries on each one of them, or basically related queries, but individual. In this example, basically we want to find the student ID, the average grade, and the number of courses that student takes. And here you basically can see from transcript, I group by student ID and I extract the student ID, the average grade, and the count. And this is where it matters with if you have null values. So null values are quite interesting. If you use them in aggregates, like for instance, this grade here, you will actually get a null grade, because any arithmetic value that a null value will be part of, you basically cannot use in an arithmetic operation. You will basically get a null value. Well, I will tell you more about null values in a couple of minutes. Having clause. So sometimes you don't want some groups. It's an analogous option to the where clause, where we wanted those tuples for which the where clause is true. But you want it only for the groups. So maybe some of the groups you want to filter them out. You only want, let's say, the students with their average and count, if the average grade is greater than 3.5, okay? From slide 48, what does the count do? So the count here, count for null values. For here, basically you get the number of tuples that are selected in the group. So it doesn't matter if they are null values. If you would have an attribute like count the number of grades, for the count actually counts null grades too. So the count here will count how many values we have in each group. So for instance, for this group that we have, the third group, it's 4, because basically you have 4 possible tuples that are obtained after you apply this grouping on student ID. So for the student ID with ID 1, 2, 3, 4, you have the average grade 3.3, and the number of tuples, the count is the number of tuples that we got. Good. So the having clause. So basically we want to filter out some of the groups, and this having condition has to be constructed out of attributes from the group by list or aggregates over the attributes that are not in the group by list. So for instance, I can have having the student ID greater than 1000. Or I can have average of the grades greater than 3.5, because average was not part of the group by. So in this example, I basically want to get the student IDs, the average, and the count for all of the students that had basically an average GPA greater than 3.5. So this having basically eliminates certain groups. So in this previous example that we had, this one, it will eliminate this student 1, 2, 3, 4, because his GPA or her GPA is less than 3.5. So it's basically kind of like a where condition, but it works on the entire group. So this, we get the student ID, the average GPA, the count from the transcript, where the course code is like CSE. This will basically filter out for those students, for the courses that are in the computer science department. And we group by the student ID, and for every group, we compute the average grade, and we only keep those that have the average GPA greater than 3.5. So we filter that previous example that we had for those that have GPA greater than 3.5, okay? Another example, we want the name and address for all of the seniors on Dean's list. So there are two different ways to write this query, and one is wrong and the other one is correct. So the first one is that we select the ID and the name, and from the student and transcript tables, we create a join between those two tables. We create a natural join, basically those on equal join, those in which the student ID is the same with the transcript student ID. The status is senior. So this basically will give me all the students that are senior and their corresponding transcripts, grades for every course. Then we group by, we can group in two different ways. If we group by student ID, then we cannot extract in the select statement the name. So the problem is really that the variables that appear here in the select part, the attributes that appear in the select part, they have to be either attributes that were in the group by, or they have to be aggregates of the rest of the attributes. So s.name is not an aggregate. So it has to be included as part of the group by condition. So every attribute that occurs in the select clause must also occur in the group by clause, or it must be an aggregate. So that's basically a rule about the attributes that appear in the projection. And since s.name doesn't appear in the group by, only the second condition is correct. And again, we have a having part, which states that the average grade should be greater than 3.5. And the sum of the number of credits is greater than 90. That's the condition for seniors. Any questions? Okay. So here I have three more examples. In the first example, I select the count on the course code and the professor ID. Without a group by clause, this doesn't make sense. So basically, let's say that this is from teaching. And this doesn't make sense. If you don't have a group by, you can't compute an aggregate together with an ID. So group by is necessary if you try to extract an aggregate for certain groups of tuples. In the second example, I count all the grades in the teaching, and the average of all of the grades. So which is fine, because these are two aggregates over the same whole relation. In the third example, I have a select from where the grade is greater than a count of some other select. Now, this is not how we write if we do want to write that the grade is greater than some count. In that case, we would have a select count. So the order of having these two here is wrong. You can have a comparison of a grade with a count, but the count has to be extracted separately as part of the inner select. So if you do something like this, then this is fine. This basically selects from the first table where the grade is greater than, and then we select a value from the second table. It is not the other way around. You can't put count outside and then count the tuples, because this basically will bind the count over an aggregate over the first relation, not an aggregate over the second relation. So basically it's syntactically incorrect. This is not accepted by SQL. Order by. So after you selected on a group and you check that it has some condition, the group has some condition, you can order. And really all of these are optional. You can group and order, you can just have order and not group or having and so on. So order by descending cumulative AGPA, ascending student ID is totally correct. And basically the way that it works is that you have multiple conditions for the ordered by, and it will start ordering by the first condition, like descending by cumulative GPA. So the 4.0 GPAs are first, 3.9 are next, and so on. If there are multiple students with the same GPA, it will apply the second condition for sorting. So the students with a smaller student ID will be listed first. It's kind of like seniors that have a 4.0 GPA are higher in rank than juniors with 4.0 GPA. Okay, so the ordered by clause causes the rows to be ordered after you obtain the tuples that you had before. So it's really, you execute them in this specific order. So first you evaluate the from clause, which produces a Cartesian product, let's say A of the tables in the from list. Then you evaluate the where clause, which filters the Cartesian, those tuples that we obtained in the first step on some where condition, the condition is true. Once we have these tuples, we do the group by, which partitions that set B in the previous step into groups that agree on the value of group by. Then we evaluate having, but really you cannot have having unless you have group by. So basically having is necessary because otherwise without having groups, you don't have to have a having. So it what having does, it eliminates the groups in B that do not satisfy the having condition, that the having condition is false. Once we have that, we evaluate the select. That means we basically produce the table of rows for the attributes that we project on. So basically, and we compute aggregates over the groups. So basically you compute averages and so on. And then you return back and you evaluate the order by, because the order by may actually use some of the aggregates to order. So for instance, the cumulative GPA may be actually used. The cumulative GPA is one of these labeled attributes, and you can basically use it for ordering the columns in the result. So it's very important that you know this order and the fact that some of them are working tangential to the previous ones. Like having, it's a step, but it has to be after group by, because otherwise it doesn't make sense. It doesn't eliminate the groups. So really, if you want to see it, is that you have the first part is the select from where, which basically does a Cartesian product and a filter, and you get a set of tuples as the result of select from where. Then you do the group by, which groups those tuples into subgroups. Then you execute the having part, which for every subgroup, it checks the condition in the group, and some of the groups will be filtered out. So the first group and the third group in this example are filtered out. We get a couple of other groups. Then we execute the aggregates in the select clause, which will give you some results back. And then you order them by the conditions that you have in ordered by. So this order is very, very important because it actually tells you how the result will be presented to you afterwards. Okay. Now, before we move to views in SQL, do you have any questions? So let's move to views. So views are actually a dynamic relation. They are, the rows are not physically stored in the system, and the view is computed whenever it's used within an SQL statement. So basically, if you need, let's say, a view as a join of two relations and a filter, you don't compute, these rows are not materialized. You basically compute it the moment that you query from that view. And really, a view is just a name, an alias for a previous select statement. A select statement that was declared, that this view was created as that select statement, you would basically name the view. The advantage is that from now on, you can use that view as basically that query. So you can actually use the in operator to check if there is a result in that view. And that view is just an alias for the select statement that we saw before, that we have before. So like, for instance, I have a select statement that selects a student ID and the average grades in, and this select statement groups by student and computes the average grades. I can create another virtual relation, which is this view, cumulative GPA, with the attributes student ID and cumulative GPAs. So I basically even can change the names of the attributes whatever that we get out. You can use them afterwards in other select statements. So now I can select from cumulative GPA and the student and give basically the name and the cumulative GPA for those students where the student in the view and the student ID are the same. So we do a join and the cumulative GPA is greater than 3.5. So from the all the cumulative GPAs for all the students, I select those students that have the GPA greater than 3.5. So views are just names for previously defined relations for select statements. So this is a very good question. Views are definitely updated when the table that on which are based on are changed. So basically, if the table changes, the view is updated. Now, the updating is done in an incremental way. So there is a red graph algorithm that was basically developed in the 90s that basically, if you modify, if you delete or update or insert a new statement in a table, it incrementally updates the view. So you only change the tuples that are dependent on the ones that, but this is internally to the DBMS. So basically, yes, the answer is that views are always updated and they are not updated real time. They are basically incrementally updated. You don't have to do the entire query again. But there are other issues with views. So they are good for the point that now you can give access to a user directly to a view, and the user will not need access to the base tables. So in the previous lecture, I told you that there are three levels, the physical level, the conceptual level, and the application level. And for each of them, you can give access to different users. So for instance, for a certain application, like to students, you give access to grades, to their own grades. For professors, you give access to the grades of the students they teach, not to other students. For the billing accountants in the administration, you give access to billing information. So really, it is a way to do security control. Who has access to what? And basically that's the external schema that every single different user has access to, and that's composed out of views. Views allows owners to provide select access to a subset of columns, because you can project only on those columns that you want to show to a certain user, or to provide a certain update or insert access to the database. And last time I actually gave you this example, gave you an example that you grant select access on a certain table to Joe. We created a new user Joe, and you can do the same for views. You don't need to give access to Joe for the original tables. You give access to Joe only on the view, and this is really internally analogous to giving access to Joe on the transcript table for a certain set of columns. Moreover, it actually select access not for every semester, but only for the semester fall of 2020. Now, there are benefits to views, and those are that each user sees only the complexity of database they need. They don't need access to other parts of the database. Also, a view can be parameterized. You can actually set it up as a subroutine like in a programming language. I will show you basically how do we do stored subroutines in one of the future classes. And in that way, you can reuse the same view, but for actually different users. Now, there are multiple problems with views, but one problem that is not with views in particular, but with null values. So we said earlier that when you create a table, you can state that some columns cannot be null, but by default, except if the current column is a key, it can be null, which basically means that if I don't have a grade, like for instance, transcript contains the courses that the student takes in fall of 2020, but the grade is zero or null yet, okay? What happens with null for arithmetical operations, counts, and other things? So first of all, this is the SQL 92 semantics, and which is still today the same semantics for null values. If a null takes place in an arithmetical operation that includes plus, minus, multiplication, then the result is also null. So for instance, if you have a where clause, and in that clause you have price divided by cost, but there is no specified price, then you have null divided by cost, which will be evaluated to null. If you have a conditional operation, like greater than, less than, different, equal, and so on, greater than, equal, less than, equal, then if you one of the values is probably an arithmetical operation and is null, then the operation between a null and something else gives you a new value that is called unknown or undefined. So whenever one of the operands is null, you basically get a null value between the two operations. So if you do where the cost is greater than price and price is null, we don't know the price or we don't know the cost, then the result of this expression is also null. It's the result of this expression is unknown. But now what happens with unknown? Like basically we have a where clause and we have some condition like an and or an or a not over an unknown. Also SQL 92 defines what do we do with this three valued. So we have true and undefined is undefined. True or undefined is true. So, and this is totally normal because if you think about it, if you already know that one condition is true, it really doesn't matter that the second one is undefined. We don't know its value or we cannot compute its value because something was null. Then the condition is still true. If we have false and undefined, the disjunction between false and undefined is unknown, because actually depends on this unknown, because if it would have been true, then the disjunction would have been true. But false and undefined is false, because again, it doesn't matter what the second one is. The first one was already false. Undefined and undefined, or undefined or undefined, which are the two options here, are basically undefined. Now, once in the where condition, the value is false or undefined, then the rows are discarded. So there are many different places. Yes, undefined and unknown are the same, because undefined really means that there is no known value about that. Actually, they mean the same if you think about one says that is undefined, the other one is that we don't know its value. Yes, that's true. I was looking what is the correct name in the SQL standard, and it is undefined. So I wrote it here as undefined or unknown, but I really mean it as undefined. I just wanted to show you that it really could mean unknown. Undefined or unknown means unknown. Yes. There are other instances where you have issues with the null. Like for instance, you select the sum of two attributes. So in the part of the projection, you have null. And what do you do then? You basically do, you will get also null as part of the tuples that will be resulted out of that select statement. Kevin is asking, is undefined the same with unknown? Yes, it's, I mean the same thing. Undefined is the word that is used in the SQL standard. Okay, there is another question by Kevin.
Yeah, it's above what Joseph said.
Okay, I think I missed all of these questions. So can you remind me what was the question?
Yeah, Kevin asked, how is Vue different from granting access?
Oh, good. So a Vue is a dynamic Vue. It's a name, an alias for a select statement. Granting access, you can grant access directly on a table, or you can grant an access like select access or update access on a view. Now, there is a problem, and I will show it to you when you do grant access on a update on a view. What happens, what basically it means if you update a view? It's the most problematic part in SQL, because you can't update a view. A view is basically the result of a select statement. So the access is basically part of the access control, that who has access to this view, who can do select statements or updates on a view, or who does updates or directly on a relation on a table.
Okay, cool. Joseph's maybe ventured a guess about read-only versus write. Is there a difference between those?
Yes. So after we do a few more of these, I have here. So these are the insert and update and delete and so on. We talked about some of these. But now the problem with views is you create a view. You can give access and you can take access from the view, including updates. And what happens with if you try to update a salary? Because the salary is an aggregate, probably, or something else over the view. So sometimes you can't do anything about that. So I put here a few problems that I will go over in a couple of minutes. But okay, yes, we will go over some of those issues.
Sorry, I didn't mean to get you off
topic. No. And one other thing, last class, actually, I believe we actually covered the different accesses that can be given to somebody. So we have the grant references, grant select statement, grant update. So we did a few of these. What type of access you can grant on a table? And you can grant any one of these. You can grant select. That means that somebody can query a table. You can grant insert. That means that somebody can insert into a table, delete. They can do updates, like change the value of an attribute. References, you grant access to references and change. Checking reference, changing the reference. And we talked about on cascade, which basically if you change a foreign key, now it will also change the primary key in the table to which this foreign key was pointing to. Or you can grant all privileges. That basically means select statement, insert, delete, update, and references on a table. And we talked a little bit more about granting references last time. You can also, after you grant access, you can revoke the access for a set of accesses on an object. I can go again over this after we cover the current class.
Yeah, no worries. I can review some of that as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Now, one more thing about null values. So aggregates. How do the different aggregates work with nulls? Count counts nulls. For instance, if you say count all of the grades that the student got, it counts the nulls too. So if, for instance, Paul got A in a class, B in a class, and currently is taking two classes, so there are two nulls in the transcripts, the count will give me that Paul basically took four classes. It counts the nulls, it also counts the other values. Okay? But however, other aggregates ignore nulls. So average over basically the set of grades will only compute the averages for the grades that were computed. So it will compute the average between A and B, but it will not include the nulls. So it will basically sum those two grades, 4.0 and 3.4, and divide it by in 3.2 and divide it by 2, the number of grades that have a value. So it's quite interesting because count counts the nulls, but when we do average, it computes the average over the two grades that are not null. So it's quite interesting how they set up the semantics of different aggregates versus nulls in the table. Now, a few more things that are in the SQL standard, inner joins. So we basically talked about joining with comma. Like we basically had, let me show you. I think this one. So when we have a comma, basically we have an example like, this one. No, this one is still one table. This one. From cumulative GPA and student between these two tables, we have to use in the where condition a part that basically does the join for us. So we need the condition explicitly when we have a join and we don't want the Cartesian product between the two. In SQL, there is a special word called join, which basically what it does is the join of the two tables. So from table one, join table two, it basically it's a join between the two tables and is basically a way to get the results out of those tables. So an inner join is basic or a join, a standard join, it does matches between all of the columns with the same name. So if there is a column that matches with the same name, it's like a natural join. It basically for those columns, it does the join. So it's really like the comma that we have seen before. The difference is between the nulls. What happens with the nulls? So we have left joins. A left join returns all the rows from the left table with matching rows in the right table. So we have additional attributes. So when we have attributes, when we have an inner join, we basically specify the column names that we want to keep. But with a left join, it will keep all of the attributes from table one and all of the rows. For those for which I have the table two, it basically returns all of the rows from the left table with matches rows in the right table. And the result will be null in the right side when there is no match. So here are two examples, really left join between table one and table two, where some condition on table one column name is equal with table two column name, we return all of the results and for those values in table one in which I don't have a value for the table two column name, it basically just keeps the tuple in the result, but the values in the attributes of table two are null. And that's what is called a left join or a left outer join. A right join does exactly the opposite. It returns all of the rows from the right table, table 2, with matching rows in the first table. And in the first table, it keeps null on the left-hand side where there is no match to the second table. And again, there are two keywords, right join or right outer join. Full outer join. It combines the result of both left and right joins. It's like a union and then minus the intersection of two tables. So if there are values in table 1 that are not in table 2, they will be kept. If there are values in table 2 but not in table 1, they will be kept. But for those that have values in common, it basically keeps those values and does the join. So you have the attributes in table 1 together with attributes in table 2 for the same value. Comma join, it's basically what we used up to now, where we enumerated all of the possible conditions and we did a Cartesian product between the various tables. And then we selected a certain set of attributes out. Now, a comma join is basically the same with this inner join that we have here. So we select on sales header, we select from customer where it does an inner join with sales, such as the customer ID is the same with the customer ID in customer. And then we select with an inner join from sales order detail, which basically checks again the sales order is the same with the sales order in the previous step or in the customer. The condition can be each one of the previous relations. And then we have an inner join with product, and then we have an inner join with person. And for each one of them, we specify directly which filter condition is considered. So it's actually, this is obtained out of the optimization for the previous one. So the previous one, SQL is a declarative language. The previous one, basically, it's a way to declare, I want from these tables where the condition is true. So it's straightforward for us to understand as users. The second one is good when you basically are still writing the join and you can specify more efficiently on what column are you joining with the previous table. So it's basically a way to also direct the interpreter, this SQL database, how to compute the join. I personally like the first one, but there are many people that like the second one because you can command individual rows. So if I don't want one join here, I can comment it out and then I still get the result out of the rest of the joins. I can see that the same thing can be done in the one above if you just put one table per line and one condition per line and then you would select the correct condition with the correct table that needs to be commented out. So I personally don't see any use for inner joins. Outer joins are a little bit a different idea. The idea of outer joins is that if you have two tables and you want to keep all of the tuples from the first table, but for those values that I don't have a value in the second table, I want them as null, you can basically use an outer join. You can implement the same thing, but with a union and modifying the where condition. You can also do it with a where condition, but use the star equal, and that basically means a left outer join, and a right outer join would be equal star. So in a statement like this one, when you do this equality between attributes, you can use a star to specify that you are still interested in those tuples, even if on the other side they have a null value. So again, the join condition makes it easier to add and eliminate tables when you do troubleshooting. I'm not finding it very useful, but maybe you will. The like operator. So we said earlier that you can compare attributes with equal, greater than, less than equal, different, and greater than equal. But for strings, we would also like to compare them with a pattern. Like for instance, I want the courses that start with CSE, or I want all the customers with a city starting with the letter S, and the country containing the pattern land, and the country not like Greenland. So I can specify this basically. The city is like percent S, that basically means it starts with the letter S. The country like percent land percent. Actually, the first one is ends with the letter S because really the percent is before. If I want start, I will put it after. The third one, the second one is that it contains land anywhere in the string. And the fourth one, it's a country that is not like green land. So basically doesn't contain green at any position in the string. Now there are many different wildcards. So the one that you saw there was percent, which it's a substitute for 0 to more characters. Underscore stands for a single character. If you put characters within brackets, it's a sets or range of characters to match. It's exactly like regular expressions. You can put A to Z or A to C, countries that start with a lower letter or a vowel. You can do disjunction by just enumerating the characters that you basically want in the disjunction. If you put a hat in front of it, it means that it doesn't match the characters in that list, or the same you would obtain with exclamation sign. And here is an example. I want customers where the city starts with L, then a letter, then N, then starts with another, then another letter, and then ends with O and N. Like for instance, London or Linden and so on. Between operator. So if you don't want to write two conditions that the column name is greater than value one and less than value two, you can basically use between and. So for instance, if I want products with prices between 10 and 20, I can use between and end. In operator, we have seen it before. If you have a set of values, either that is obtained from a where, from another select statement, or you have an enumeration, you can use the in operator. You basically specify that that attribute is one of the values in the next set. MySQL has a lot of date functions, which are useful when you want to do any kind of date operations. Like a student can register for a class after November 5th. So for that, for such conditions, you would need dates. So now returns the current date and time. Current date, car date returns the current date. Car time returns the current time. Date extracts the date part of date time expression. Extract returns a single part of the date and time. So you can extract hour or extract day. Date add, you can add a specific time interval to a date. So you can add a number of days or a week. Sub does exactly the same. Date diff returns the number of days between two dates, like how many days have passed between now and November 5th. And you can basically get the date difference. Date format displays the date into different formats. You can state in English format or European format, day followed by month, followed by year, or you can display it in American standard format, month, day, year, and so on. Limit. Limits the number of rows returned. In MySQL, like for instance, let's say that you get 1,000 rows. You can't use them or even present them in a web page. So you would basically limit the number of results returned by some number. in SQL Server, in Microsoft SQL Server, you specify top. And this top can actually contain not only the number, but it can contain the percentage. Like, I want the first 10% of the rows for that column name, for those columns names. It's basically, it can be both count and percentage, as opposed to MySQL, where I basically get only the number. And now, last time we covered a couple of commands. If you remember, we did insert. So right at the end, we had, here are the insert statements that we inserted last time. So I will go over this. Like, you basically have the attributes that were defined in the create table, and then you can insert in two different ways. You can insert with specifying the attributes and then the values corresponding to those attributes, or you can ignore, you can basically leave out the attributes and just specify the values, like I did in this example, insert into students values, and then I just specify the values in the order that they were defined in the create table. Bulk insert. So if you want to insert from a select statement, like for instance, I created a table dean's list with student ID, credits, and cumulative GPA, and then I insert into dean's list the student ID, credits, and cumulative GPA, which those are obtained from a select statement. I select from another, the transcript table, grouping by student ID with average grade greater than 3.5 and the count greater than 30. I basically select the student ID, 3 multiply with the count and the average grade. And that is included in the dean's list. So really, I consider every class to be of 3 credits. So this basically returns the number of credits. And it's a select, a bulk insert. Delete. So it's similar to the select clause, only that keyword that is used is delete from. So we have no need to specify what. Then we specify the table from which we want to delete, and we specify the condition where the grade is null and the semester is different than fall of 2020. So this basically deletes all of the rows for incomplete grades that were not given in a previous semester. Update. So I want just to update a salary for a specific employee or for all of the employees in a specific department. So update the employee table. We set the salary to be the previous salary multiplied with 1.05, 5% increase, where the department is research and development. So basically this is an update. It's like a select statement, but you don't need the from, and you basically the from is the here, and you don't need the attributes that on which you project. It's similar to delete from or update, and the table that you want to update. Now, there is a problem. Since views are obtained from tables, can they be updated? And the answer is yes, because you can modify some views. Like for instance, if I create this view, and the view really contains the student ID, the course, and the semester as directly mapped to one transcript. If I see that something is wrong, like for instance, the course code is wrong, somebody mistyped 316 into 315, then it's easy. I can update the view CS reg with where the student, where the course code is equal with CSC 315 into the course is equal with CSC 316. So I basically just have to update that view, set the course is equal with 316, where the previous course was equal with 315. So the answer is yes, you can update views. However, there are problems with updating views. So for that previous table, let's say that we have this insert statement, insert student ID, course, semester, and these values. what values should we place in the other attributes? Like, for instance, the grade. And the answer is simple, null. Because by default, you should assume that there is no grade. And that's really kind of like unknown. Or some other default value. Maybe there in the create table, there was a default of at least 2.0 for the grade. So the answer, this is the first problem with updating views. The second problem with updating views. So again, I have an update. And the problem is that this is an insert into that table. And there is no, the problem is that there is a new tuple not in the view. And the solution is that, again, we allow insertion, assuming that there is a check constraint and nothing is violated. And we basically inserted in the underlying table, the transcript table, this data that we inserted in the view. The third problem, the update to a view might not uniquely specify the change to the base table that results in the desired modification of the view. So we create a view, let's say professor department, which has the professor name and the department name. And that is the result of a professor with a department join. So now we have a problem that if we insert a new tuple in this view, it will have to modify two different tables because this new tuple maybe is inserted because we noticed that a certain department was not listed for a professor, or that the professor was not listed in the correct department, or that the professor is now hired in a new department that never existed before, in which case we have to update two different tables. We have to insert the professor and we insert the department, the corresponding department. So it's not a unique mapping of between views with the underlying tables, especially if this is a join between multiple tables, which is the case, because otherwise, why would you create views if you don't actually have some complex query underneath? So now multiple problems. If we delete a tuple from department professor, what does it mean? We delete the professor from the professor table. We delete the department from the department table, or we update the role for Professor Smith in professor by setting the department to null, which all of them may seem as good ideas, but I don't know which is the correct one. And that's why updating views are problematic. So updating views are restricted to those in which no Cartesian product from the from clause exists, no aggregates, no group by conditions, and no having. So for instance, this is another example of a problematic update. We have a view that computes the department ID and the average salary for the professors in that department. And this is from a single table, employee. And we group by department ID. How do we handle if we update that basically the average salary is multiplied with 1.1, like a 10% increase? Normally what should happen is that everyone in that department gets a 10% increased salary, but this is not what happens because average means average. Average can be obtained in different ways. It can be obtained that one person out of 10 gets double the salary. And then there is basically no, the average is still 10% higher, but only one person was promoted. Now, there are also security constraints over the databases. And this is actually the most important slide that I want to tell you about. And this is what is called the SQL insertion. So let's assume that you write a web page in Node.js or some other website. And in that web page, you read a social security number. And really what you want to do underneath is that you select from customers all of the tuples where the social security number was the value that was put in the input. And this is a totally correct thing. Like basically the user enters his social security number and we return all of the tuples for that user. Like for instance, all of the purchases for that user. And we are expecting a social security number as a 9-digit number. What if the user enters some number of digits or one equal with one? So now the query that you will basically run over the database, because you concatenate a SQL query with a value, will be select all the tuples from customers where the social security number is this number or one is equal with one, which is always true, which will cause the database to return all of the records in the database. So maybe we were expecting to get, I mean, the user was a normal user, a correct user would expect to get all of the tuples related to him, to that user. But in this case, we're actually getting all of the tuples for all customers. So it's basically a security flaw. So the solution really, and the only possible solution, is that we scan the input and we assure that it meets the requirement and the format. 9-digit number, no special characters, returns an error if the input is not correct and you don't run a query over the database for an input that you haven't verified. And really in this example, it doesn't matter what you enter as the number. You could have entered just 4 nines. Still it's maybe 9 characters long, or even like this and this 9 characters long, but it's not actually what we expected. And it's a security flaw in the database, in your application, not in the database. There is nothing in the database that we can do about this, because the database just runs whatever query is given. The application is the problem in this case. Okay. Any questions? So one other thing that I want to cover today is how do you query MySQL from Node.js? So basically Node.js has a MySQL package, which you need to install if you want to query your MySQL database. So I'm going to do it, cmd. Let's change to the desktop. And the first thing that you need to do is to make sure that the MySQL package is installed. So npm node package manager install MySQL. In my case, I already installed it. So basically it's, I don't get any error. I basically get only warnings that there are some other issues with this database. One other thing that you have to do is that this package, this driver is using the, when you install MySQL, it will ask you if you want the latest security way to identify a user, or you want the older security way. And this package only works with the older password credentials. So you need to run these two commands in MySQL. So if you have MySQL on your system, you should basically connect to it and run these two queries. Actually, I can run them. I don't want to run them in the command line. I could, but I can run them in the MySQL workbench. So I can basically put both commands. It alters the table for my password. And let's specify my password. It's all correct. So let's run them, run and run. Actually, let's stop it. Let's try the same two commands. My password is password root. And then flush privileges.
That's is there a typo in privileges?
I think so, but okay. This is embarrassing, but where is the typo? Ada, no D. Thank you. I knew that something is wrong with that word. Not with the word, with my spelling of it. Thank you. Okay. So once we have that, we can basically run in my node these commands. So the first one requires that specific driver. So let's run node. And then we basically require the MySQL. We create a connection to the database. And we let's create a new table. So this creates a new database schema. My DB, and it actually worked. So basically, no, actually it didn't. I probably have already that specific database already exists. So let me delete the database. Drop schema. What was the name? My DB. Okay, and now we can basically, I'm not in MySQL, I'm in Node. Minus P. Okay, so now here I can basically, run node again, and let's try the whole thing. Maybe this time it works. Database created. So everything was fine. We created the connection, we created the connection to the database, and then we ran the query which creates a new database, MyDB. Second is if you want to create tables. So for the same, I can create a new connection for the database, and now I specify that this is for the database MyDB. So okay, and now it created a table. So basically we created that function that creates a new table, customers. And now I basically want to insert in that table. So you read something from the command line and you want to insert in that table. So one record is inserted. Now you want to select all customers, in particular the one that you just inserted. And basically now we got a JSON that specifies actually an object in JavaScript that specifies that the row that I just selected. So if you have problems installing basically this package and querying with it, please see us during office hours. We can help you with it. And thank you for correcting that word. Okay, any questions?
Wait, Professor, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Like, can you show us how to set up a database in the MySQL workbench? Because I have never used it before.
Okay.
Please, thank you.
No problem. Okay, so let's run the workbench. So first of all, you will have by default a connection to the local machine. And now you can basically create a new schema. So create schema. Let's call it CSC 316. So now this basically was updated, and if we refresh here, we have the new schema CSC 316. And if you double click on it, it's using that schema. Another way is actually to just specify in the command line use and that schema that you want to use. You can do the same in command line. So basically, if you run MySQL and you have the in the path variable minus u and then the user minus p and then the password, you basically logged in with the command line client to MySQL. And now you can do the same. You can use the database that you created before, like CSC 316. And in this database, you can create new tables. So let's create student, and then you specify the attributes like name of the type varchar, let's say of 10 characters, GPA, which is number, and so on. I have an error here, which it's probably that I have to use real for types. If you want integers, let's say that I have another table, professor, and professor has number of years that he worked in that job, you can basically specify integer. And now you can start inserting rows into these tables. So insert into, let's say, professor, and you specify the values, the tuples that you are looking for. So insert Paul and insert other people, Kevin, 5. Michael, 25. And now you can query. So select all rows from professors where years is greater than 7. So now you basically get the results for those years that are greater than 7, Paul and Michael. If you want greater than 4, you get more rows and so on. And you can exit with exit. The database is persistent. So the same database that I see here, I can start querying here. So select star from professors. It basically gives me the same tuples. And if I want, I can query it from node. So I will just modify the last program that I have in the examples. So I'm basically connecting now to CSC 316. And instead of selecting from customers, I will select from professors. So now this will give me all the professors that I have in that database. And it gave me Paul, Kevin, and Michael with their corresponding years.
I see. Thank you so much, Professor.
Welcome.
I also have one more question. Is the password, like the username and the password for like connecting to the database?
When you install it for the first time. So when I installed MySQL, the default username is root, but the password you will be asked when you install the database for the first time, what is the password that you want to use? So it's not a default password. This is something that I'm using myself. I basically put it password root, but you can use any password that you want as long as you remember it. It's not like Postgres. In Postgres, you are using the user credentials for the operating system. So for instance, on my Linux server, I have a Postgres database that is mapped to the user credentials of the operating system. For MySQL, you basically define your password when you install the database. And you can add additional users. We covered that again last class. We created user with the password that you want to identify him with. But you need a root password. So you need basically the one that you create when you create the when you install the server.
Thank you.
Welcome. Other questions? Let me also check the chat. Okay, we already did the last question.
I have a question on the homework 4. Would you recommend using React for that?
Not really. If you want, you can, because the advantage of React is that you can develop one-page applications. But you can, yes, use it, because I would say that it's a good experience. So you should, because it gives you already how do you use React in bigger projects. So yes, I would recommend that you do use it.
Okay, awesome. Thanks.
Welcome. I think I already responded, how do you connect to the database? So to that question, I basically, that's the point of the last set of lectures that we did, which basically it's how do you connect from, it's this connection that we created to the database from the driver.
Okay. So if we were accessing a database not on our machine, we'd change things like host, user, and password?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I did it only for Node.js because, I mean, I can tell you how to do it in JDBC, but I think the point of this class is to learn one way and then for Node, we covered it. But if you want, I can put additional notes about JDBC in the on the webpage. In our course website, I can put in parallel with this lecture here, how do you do it in JDBC or other languages. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you very much. And I will stop the recording.